So every year, publications like US, US News and World Report, and Times Higher Education compile a ranking of the world's universities. You might not be surprised to find out that Oxford, MIT, Cambridge, Stanford, Harvard, Yale, and Princeton are often listed as top institutions. But you might wonder how Italian universities fare in global ratings. After all, the first university ever was founded in Bologna in the year 1088. And other Italian institutions like the universities of Pavia, Padua, Naples, or the so-called Normale in Pisa, have a long tradition of academic excellence. As of today, some Italian universities, so Pisa, Bologna, or the Polytechnics of Milan and Turin, rank in the world's top 200. And some are in top positions for certain specific categories. So according to QS, the Polytechnic of Milan is sixth in the world for design. Bocconi University is the overall 11th business school. And the University of Rome, La Sapienza, is the number one university for classics and archaeology. So despite limited public investment, so universities in Italy are primarily funded by the state, despite the dramatic escalation of the brain drain phenomenon, and despite the need for major reform, Italian universities are still very solid institutions. Unlike the Anglo-Saxon emphasis on flexibility and problem-solving, Italian academia is mostly rooted in a model centered around informativity and systematicity. Sometimes this model might appear burdensome or lacking agility. However, in some instances, when the reading of a patrimony is combined with the imagination of the future, it can really lead to an interesting model of grounded innovation. Now, I want to go back to the primacy of Rome in archaeology and classics, because starting from there, we can better understand the link between heritage and entrepreneurship. I might shock you here, but archaeology is really a privileged field for understanding the link between academia and entrepreneurship. The archaeologist sums up the intellectual and moral virtues of a true entrepreneur. So studious observation, scientific discipline, spirit of adventure, ingenuity in seeing meaningful forms below the surface, ability to decode languages or situations beyond their bidimensionality, appreciation for the diversity of culture, of cultures, capacity to secure funding or promote investments, and lastly, the willingness to tell a story, communicating the life of the past in a convincing, relevant, and intelligible way. Archaeology, like the classics, is about heritage. Yes, so what we have inherited from the past. But its role, really, is primarily directed to interpreting the present and imagining the future. Conservation is not about immobile preservation, but rather about invention, appraisal, and valorization. By invention, I don't mean random production of new pioneering ideas, but rather in its Latin meaning of inventio, the finding, the unearthing, the unveiling of an existing reality. By appraisal, I mean a critical comparison with the past, seeing it anew in dialogue with the present, and giving it value. By valorization, I mean the intellectual and entrepreneurial ability to use tradition as a solid ground to create the future, without always starting from scratch, and the investment in making a universal deposit available for those who will come after us. So the archaeology then is both an intellectual and entrepreneur, making sense of diverse forms in the present, betting on certain terrains on which to dig, and providing a solid ground on which to build the future. This is also what Italian universities aspire to do. Archaeology, as an art science of rootedness and possibilities, can offer a good insight into Italy's approach to university education. But at the same time, it can also illuminate a peculiar Italian approach to innovation, as a concomitant art of finding, decoding, incorporating, modeling, interpreting, and guessing. In particular, today I want to talk about a very important Italian woman, Margherita Guarducci, scholar of classical epigraphy at La Sapienza University of Rome, and the archaeologist who located and attributed St. Peter's tomb and bones in the heart of the Vatican Basilica. As in previous archaeological discoveries, like that of Heinrich Schliemann, who first unearthed the Homeric city of Troy in the 1870s, or Howard Carter, who discovered the intact tomb of Pharaoh Tutankhamun in 1922, the work of Guarducci on the tomb of Peter has been the object of a lot of debate. My intention here is not to examine the disputes surrounding her findings, even though I invite you to do your own research about it. But the scope here is rather to present the relevance of her pioneering contribution in opening a previously unthinkable path. I also believe that her experience can illuminate the intersection of archaeology as a science of probabilities with entrepreneurship, as a similar art of courageous search, informed guesses, and audacious discoveries. So Guarducci was born in Florence in 1902 and studied in Bologna, where she graduated in classics in 1924. After attending the National School of Archaeology in Rome in 1927, she left for Greece as one of the first women at the Italian Archaeological School in Athens. From there, she moved to the island of Crete, where she directed the excavations of the ancient city of Gortyna, the discovery site of a set of Greek inscriptions from the 7th century BC, known as the Gortyn Code, which was one of the most ancient testimonies in Doric language on the laws that regulated commerce and family relations in Crete. Guarducci surveyed the island, assessed the previous excavations, and led her team to the unveiling of other artifacts related to the code. After being appointed chair of ancient Greek epigraphy at the University of Rome in 1931, she would serve there until 1973, she dedicated the first 20 years of her tenure to tracing the topography of the city of Gortyna and compiling a definitive collection of Cretan inscriptions. For those of you wondering what topography and epigraphy are, so topography is the writing of space, the mapping or a documented projection of what still lies underground. Topography is kind of a business plan. It is the attempt to chart a territory as a way to risk the exploration, the excavation, or the execution, if you want. Epigraphy is the study of inscriptions, literally what is written upon in monuments, artifacts, or testimonies from the past. We are used to the ephemerality of writing, so text messages, emails, but for the ancients, writing on stone rather than on papyrus meant writing something that could last forever, transmitting knowledge to future generations. So if someone took our writing codes, say a text message, and wrote it on stone or metal, and if in the year 4020 someone found our inscription, by then our code, our way of speaking, would appear cryptic, difficult to comprehend. So epigraphy is the study of these codes that were meant for the future, of these messages that old civilizations left for us to convey their understanding and knowledge of the world. Epigraphy, then, is an art of decrypting codes, of processing languages that have both a secretive and a public component. A little bit like the public magazines and newspapers in which Dr. Nash was trying to decipher Russian secret codes in a beautiful mind. It is by virtue of this constant reading and decryption, for example, that Guarducci saw in epigraphy, and I quote here, one of the most agile, fresh, and fun disciplines of classical studies, and I end my quote here. By virtue of her academic achievements at La Sapienza and her appointment as director of the National School of Archaeology in Rome, Guarducci was chosen in 1950 to direct the excavations in St. Peter's Basilica. A long tradition held that the church was built on the burial site of the apostle, yet for centuries no one had dared to verify this. First, because no one wanted to violate his tomb, and second, because of the risk of potential collapse in digging at the church's foundation. However, in 1939, at the death of Pope Pius XI, the traditional burial site of the popes in the grotto underneath the altar was actually full. It was his successor, Pius XII, who launched the project of excavation in the area. It was June 28, 1939, so 35 days before the beginning of World War II. While the world outside would rage in war in the early 1940s, the excavations quietly proceeded as Vatican workers found the site of a Christian necropolis and presumably the burial ground of St. Peter, marked by a number of structures organized like a Russian matryoshka doll. Now, a couple of clarifications here are needed. First, about the martyrdom of St. Peter. You might recall that in 64 AD, a fire broke out in Rome. The fire devastated the city, and Emperor Nero, as confirmed by Tacitus, blamed the early Christian community for this disaster, which was actually functional to freeing the ground for the construction of his spectacular palace, the Domus Aurea, now near the Colosseum. This was the first persecution against Christians, who were often crucified in front of the crowd in macabre circus games. Among them, the Apostle Peter also underwent capital execution, or in Christian terms, martyrdom, most likely in the Vatican Circus, whose central obelisk can be found today in the center, the very center of St. Peter's Square. Now, near the circus, there was a necropolis, so a cemetery, where St. Peter was buried. The site of the basilica actually confirmed this location and preserved it over the centuries. Why? Because the Vatican was actually a hill, was a very impervious site for building a structure like a church, a basilica. In the 4th century, after Constantine legitimized Christianity, the emperor ordered a basilica to be built on this site, in coincidence with a shrine erected in the 2nd century over the tomb. This shrine, adjacent to a red wall, is commonly referred to as the Trophy of Gaius. Now, in order to turn the site into a flat surface, the builders had to bury the necropolis, which at the time was still in use, and level the Vatican Hill in order to construct the building on the very site of Peter's tomb. The second observation has to do with the structures built over the Trophy of Gaius, which the Vatican excavators discovered in a backward order. Starting from the actual altar of Clement VIII of 1594, they found the previous altar of Callistus from 1123. And then, under this, the altar of Gregory the Great of 604, which was leaning on the monument that Emperor Constantine had built before constructing the basilica on the spot of Peter's tomb, dated 326. All over the site, the excavators found burial inscriptions on walls, as well as bones and sarcophagi that had been protected by soil for more than 1600 years after the filling in of the necropolis. Workers also found that Constantine's monument incorporated a 2nd century shrine adjacent to the so-called Red Wall, which was identified as the Trophy of Gaius. It was at this time, on Christmas Day of 1950, that Pope Pius XII, announced via radio, confirming tradition, that the tomb of Peter had been found. This is when Guarducci comes in, giving the whole project its decisive twist. A couple of issues, in fact, remained unsolved. First, there was no stone indicating the actual name of Peter in association with the burial site. And two, no bones were identified with names. Guarducci visited the excavation for the first time in 1952, and among others, hundreds of inscriptions invoking Peter and indicating closeness to his tomb, she isolated a graffito on a stone, a drawing of which had been previously published by one of the archaeologists, the Jesuit Antonio Ferrua. It was there, but no one had connected it. She decoded the inscription, whose letter sequences, Petre and Eni, over two lines of writing, composed the Greek phrase Petros Eni, meaning Peter is here, within. It is at this time that Guarducci collected also the relics that had been previously found inside the Constantinian monument, mixed with soil at the breaking of the wall by the excavators. Among them, she isolated some bone fragments wrapped in purple cloth interwoven with gold thread, setting them apart for further investigation. In this work, she adopted as a guide the scientific method of her epigraphic and archaeological work in Crete, as well as, in her own words, her love for truth. Here she is describing her attitude towards the site.
Se per caso io avessi trovato lavorando lì, insomma, qualche cosa di contrario alla tradizione, io non avrei esitato a dirlo, perché la verità, come diceva Pio XII, avanti a tutto.
If by any chance I had found while working there something contrary to tradition, I would not have hesitated to say it, because truth is above all, as Pius XII also said, end quote. Many investigations on other human remains were completed and failed in the 1950s. It was in 1962 that Guarducci entrusted the bones she had set apart to the scientific verification of the anthropologist Mario Correnti. The analysis revealed that, unlike other remnants, the bone fragments belonged to one individual, male, robust, aged between 60 and 70, matching the attributes associated to Peter's story. Correnti confirmed that the soil matched the one near the red wall and contained traces of equivalent plaster. Guarducci completed the attribution of the bones and detailed it in her 1965 book, The Relics of Peter, following her 1960 volume, The Tomb of Peter. In 1968, Pope Paul VI confirmed her identification of the relics in a message to the world. Now, the method and implications of this discovery are under constant scrutiny for archaeological reasons, mainly related to the uncareful and often unprofessional excavations of the 1940s, as well as for theological reasons related to the issue of Rome's primacy over other metropolitan churches, motivated by the very presence of Peter. As I mentioned earlier, I will leave this up to you to investigate. For our purposes, the work of Guarducci is really an example of the groundbreaking power of decoding the past, but also of the necessity to ground the future on solid terrain. Great discoverers or inventors don't necessarily know where their innovation will lead, like Edison, who invented the phonograph without knowing that his idea would create the record industry, as we saw in episode 2 on recording. Yet their contribution is really in opening a path that others might walk, discuss, engage with, and renew. That, for me, is the testimony of Margherita Guarducci, in Italian, l'archeologa e epigrafista italiana che ha identificato la tomba e le ossa di San Pietro, conservate sotto la Basilica Vaticana. That is also the reason why archaeologists are exciting academic and entrepreneurial figures, perhaps worthy of becoming heroes like Indiana Jones, who is the last intellectual who made it to cinematographic stardom. But that is a discussion for another occasion. For the moment, Thank you very much for listening, and don't forget to subscribe to the podcast at www.italianinnovators.com for episode notifications, and to follow me on LinkedIn or Twitter for updates or additional contents. Arrivederci e alla prossima!